everyone. Today, I'm glad to present my thesis project to you. I hope this presentation gives you the understanding of my vision for the future of the historic city of Anegundi. Now, I would like to take you all on a journey, a glimpse of the magical village of Anegundi, the place I came to love. Loris Malaguzzi, one of the most renowned educational philosophers, once said, "There are three teachers of children: adults, other children, and their physical environment, the latter of which is subsequently referred to as the third teacher." The project aims to bring about a change in the lives of the people of Anegundi by designing an alternative school to enhance the condition of education while allowing their livelihood and learning to coexist. In a world designed just for adults, sometimes one of the most overlooked features becomes child-centric architecture, and the one thing universal about children is that no child is the same. Children are a unique client with a heightened sensory need. The third teacher hopes to create a new realm filled with new opportunities for all the residents of the small weaving village of Anegundi. It caters to both the students and the weaving community alike. Integrating all aspects of life, the third teacher provides a platform for coexisting of the learning, teaching, and the earning categories. What this thesis aims at is to create an environment for experiential learning. When education principles are built into the learning environment, the environment transforms itself into a teaching tool. Let us realize that today's education is not a preparation for life, it is life itself. One day while watching The Simpsons show, I stumbled on an episode where the Springfield Elementary School transformed itself into a Waldorf education.
We can turn our school into a Waldorf school,
where they practice learning while doing. By the end of the episode, we can see that there is a positive growth in the students where they become curious, observant, and more attentive children.
Waldorf education focuses on hands-on activity and creative play. Waldorf education in action. We're getting our hands dirty and learning by doing.
This well-drafted reference to Waldorf education intrigued me and led me to start my research of Rudolf Steiner's ideology on children's education. Waldorf education is a pedagogy founded in 1919 based on Rudolf Steiner's educational philosophies. The curriculum in a Waldorf school is designed so that the students are engaged on more than one level. That I did was divide my site into various zones. Zones depending on privacy, level of enclosure, views, contours, vegetation, etc. Then I placed the various activities from my requirements into these different zones. This gave me the basis of the initial zoning. Next, I started scaling all my blocks in order to get a realistic image of scale and massing. The entry into the site is primarily by two ways, the pedestrian entry and the bus entry. Upon entering through the pedestrian site, the user gets a choice of four different spaces, one that leads to the admin block, one that leads to the weavers hub, one to the kindergarten, and one to the cycle or the skating rink. Standing in the pedestrian entry, you can see the largest structure of the site on the highest contour. Behind the site, there exists a number of hillocks and boulders giving a background to the site. The admin is placed closest to the entry so that the principal can see who enters and who exits the site. The patch of land next to the admin block is utilized as an agricultural land for the children to learn plantation and agriculture. If you go to the left, you come to the weaver's block, which is located amidst the coconut plantation for a solitude working environment, and the weaver's hub is connected to the library and the cafe. On the way to the cafeteria, there is a cow shed where the milk of the cow is also used for the cooking processes. You reach the entry into the gallery and the store of the library block, where the items made by the weavers are put up for display. Behind the cafeteria, there exists an organic garden where they use the vegetables grown there for the purpose of cooking also. The cafeteria is placed close to the weavers block, as the weavers also can use the space for eating. From the library and the cafe block, there is a linear vision to the common area and the faculty block. From the common areas, it gives the user a line of sight to the cafeteria. The pathway for the weavers block ends at the gallery, because these are the only two places that are utilized by the weavers. At the junction of the labs and the cafe blocks forms another pathway which takes you up on a bridge to the high school and the middle school block. The bridge stands on bamboo columns from which you can view the entire site below, as it is at the highest contour. Behind the high school and the primary block, there is a solar field generating electricity for the entire site. Connected to the high school block is the primary school block that is placed next to the orchard with flowering trees and fruit trees, making the entire grade 1 and grade 4 a colorful space. Then you reach the plaza that consists of a unique structure that can be designed by the weavers. The plaza 2 connects to the plaza 1, which consists of a watering hole. It's basically a tank of drinking water made of earthen material where everybody can come and get free drinking water. If upon entering the site you choose to go right instead of left, it leads you to the kindergarten block. The kindergarten block is placed in such a way that there are three different playgrounds, so that once you finish your first year and you go to the next and you move up, the playgrounds too change along with you. You don't have the same view or the same playground that you started with. One playground consists of a mud pit with small miniature park equipments, and the second playground consists of a fort that the children can climb up and view the surrounding buildings. The last playground basically consists of a petting zoo where children can learn rearing animals, and this builds compassion in children at an early age. If you travel to the school by cycle, you usually go right and park it in the cycle stand or the skating rink. The entry of the bus is through the right end of the site, and there is parking available for 5 buses and also a couple of autos. During programs, etc., the OAT is used, and it is located at close proximity to the entry. The first view to the admin block gives an illusion that the entire building is floating or hovering over water. The block is surrounded by water on the front three sides, making it appear to be light in weight. The entry is through a series of long steps going downwards into a small courtyard with shrubs and plants. To the left, there is the reception and the various offices behind it, the bursary, the back office and the record room that's attached to it. The principal's room has a view that is direct to the entrance and to the kindergarten block. The chairman and director's office are placed, leaving a little gap in between so that you can see the agricultural field that is in between and behind it. This is a section cut through the courtyard showing the entry. This is a section cut from the entry showing the chairman and the director's block. This section shows the reception and the waiting lobby. This shows the reception, bursary and the chairman's room. This is a section showing the principal and the vice principal's office with the views that they get. The Weaver's Hub is designed primarily for the women weavers of Anegundi, where I have tried to provide a platform for creative growth, learning and teaching. The basic idea for the Weaver's Block on campus was to design a space amidst nature in isolation from the rest of the school. This creates a type of ecosystem within itself where major interaction between the women happen within the limits of this block, and this provides a more open workspace that helps engage them with nature and move away from the typical work environment and create a more formal setting. The Weaver's Block is situated in the middle of a coconut plantation, so on all the four sides and also the sky, you see only tall coconut trees, which helps you work in solitude, inducing better creativity within the weavers. The planning consists of a single module that is multiplied four times in order to create a type of a courtyard of two intersecting axes, where on either side of the axis consists the workspace. This promotes a more engaging work environment where majority of the circulation happens at the center, creating a more lively ecosystem. Each module consists of five spaces: the workspace, the display, storage, toilets, and the most important feature, which is the staircase. Here, I tried to follow the principle of elements doing things they shouldn't be doing, and the staircase, instead of only being a way to reach various levels, acts as a semi-outdoor element, promoting maximum interaction, making it as engaging as possible. Upon entering through the main access gate, we see a huge wall with a water body below it. The wall is designed as a feature wall and is the main highlight of the block, depicting an abstract symbol of weaving. It consists of decorative light-colored concrete tiles that resembles a tapestry. The structure is made of rammed earth and consists of sloping roof, sloping inwards. The walls are made porous so that there is enough ventilation and does not confine you within the four walls. As this is their place of work, working a 9-to-5 job, it is imperative that we provide them a space with good views. Views that change with every season, views that let you experience the rain, the sun, etc. The central staircase leads to the studio workshop where young children and students of the school of Anegundi come to learn this trade by the professionals of the field. So this is the single unit of the Weaver's Block. There you have the storage, the workspace and the toilets. Once we open, you can see the roof structure. There are foldable doors and there are steps below, and those are the workspaces in between. In the back wall, you can see the porosity of the wall structure for good ventilation. There's a swing and staircase which promotes interaction between the other weavers. The library and the cafeteria block is the second biggest structure on the site. The basic idea I had while designing this block was to create a space that is inviting, interesting, and intriguing to all age groups of students, parents, and guests alike. The idea was that I wanted this building to be designed in such a way that makes people want to stop and stare. At first glance, we noticed that the structure is divided into various levels of different heights, having ramps, staircases, slides, sloping roofs, courtyards, skylights, and more. The first question I asked myself was, what are the experiences that I should create in the different zones of the structure? The ground floor of the structure consists of the majority of the public functions. The ground floor is divided into two zones, the left zone and the right zone. The left zone has the museum, the gift shop, gallery, ramp, etc. The right zone has the cafeteria, the toilets, the spiral staircase and all of that. The ramp leads to the mezzanine floor and the spiral staircase leads to the first floor. When you enter into the left zone, the ramp sort of invites you to climb up to the mezzanine floor, which further lets you reach the summit of the structure. So my main goal was to create experiences for a child to discover, a place that has scope for the imagination. The staircase leads to the cafeteria block, where there is a wall with a notice board of the specials of the day, etc., behind which there is a hand wash station. There is a serving area where one takes food and goes to the seating space to eat, and once done, there are dustbins located right next to the plate wash and the utility area where they can pass the plates back into the hole for them to wash. There is a male and a female toilet. There is a staircase leading to the library on the first floor where once you finish eating or before you eat, you can go take a snack, read, and then come back. On the other side to the entry of the museum, you see that there is a huge ramp taking you to the mezzanine floor. There is also a gallery display where the students display their works of art. Also, weavers can display their works too. There is a gift shop behind for the guests and tourists who are interested to buy the works of the weavers. The ramp takes you to the mezzanine floor. The journey from the bottom of the ramp to the top allows you to see the courtyard in between it, and you reach the mezzanine floor library, which is the smaller of the two libraries. Also, you will see that there is a slide finishing on this level. The faculty block was designed keeping in mind that the teachers are not only a part of the school community, but a community within themselves. They spend most of their time in this room, sometimes late hours and even on the weekends and holidays, and it is imperative to give them a feeling of wanting to stay. I've tried achieving this phenomenon by using light, vegetation, levels, openness, etc., making the space as interactive as possible. The entry into the faculty block is through a conversation pit, and as you walk through the foldable doors, you will see that the entire block is a separate ecosystem by itself. You have a huge water body at the central zone, which has a series of staircases leading to the mezzanine floor above it. And when you walk in, you don't see a blank and boring wall on the opposite side, but you see long glass windows that let you look out to the garden on the other side. There is a lobby space on the left side, which is surrounded by greenery around it. So this doesn't give you a feeling of being enclosed or captivated. It gives you a freeing experience. So when the faculty decides to take a break, they want to sit down and talk to each other, they can use the lobby space where I've provided a space for a coffee counter, a small kitchen table, etc. The washrooms are right next to the lobby. I've separated it as the male and the female washroom. And towards the right side of the plan, you see a block called the discussion room. So basically, this is a room where the students, etc., want to have a one-on-one discussion with the teacher, or suppose there's few students that are lagging behind and the teacher needs to give special importance or attention to them. So this discussion room is present within the close proximity to the faculty room so that the children can come learn from the teacher and go back. It's a series of three staircases with blackboards, and there is a long window that views out into the garden, so you don't feel completely enclosed in the space as well. Here, I've drawn a section running entirely through the faculty block where you see all the activities happening. You see the faculty room, the entry into the lobby, the toilets, the detention room, etc. You also see that there are huge windows, the hole in the wall, the jali wall, the pinwheel notice board, and the main skylight about the staircase and the water body. The section that is cut through the lobby space, you see that there is a private garden just for the faculty, which is provided by a boundary of jali wall. The faculty block on the second floor, that is the mezzanine floor, also consists of certain seatings for visiting faculty, etc. Another section that I have cut shows the smaller section of the faculty block with the water body and the staircase taking you up to the mezzanine floor. This block also consists of the common areas. You have the labs, the art room, the music room, etc. that are all situated right opposite the faculty block. The idea behind the design of these blocks was to immerse the students into the activities and give a separate identity for each of the blocks. In most schools, a lab is a typical room with a larger dimension than the classroom, and labs are usually placeless. One night, the labs can be interchanged and no one would even know. So, I wanted to design the labs that when you walk in, you don't need to see the instruments kept on the shelves to know what kind of a lab it is, but you will see the architecture and realize that this lab is used for this activity. I wanted to give the labs an identity instead of considering them as obsolete. There are common areas in the common area shares a discussion ground that consists of a conversation pit with lockers and a huge staircase that leads to the first floor. As you walk into the common block, you'll find a 3-meter wide corridor that opens up into the various labs. The corridor also gives you a linear vision to the library block that is framed between the two parallel walls. The first block is the biology block that upon entering you see large windows and a wall that is open to a private garden where they grow hibiscus and various other plants that are used by the biology lab for experimentation. For the biology lab, I have designed it in such a way that you will feel that you are among nature, because what else is the best way to learn about biology without being around nature? The second block that you see is the food lab. The food lab is a place for experimentation of various recipes and foods that is an important feature in the Waldorf curriculum, where children learn by doing, and it's hands-on learning all the way. The food lab also has an organic garden where students grow their own vegetables, etc. Next comes the chemistry lab. Upon entering the chemistry lab, you will see that the wall opposite the entry consists of a structure that is made to resemble the periodic table. It was also imperative that all the labs that I design have a different view so that years later when you look back at your school days, you'll picture the difference in each space and the memories won't be clouded of spaces resembling each other. The chemistry lab also has a window that lets the students peep into the physics lab and acts as a visual medium of communication with friends. The last lab on the ground floor is the physics lab that opens into the semi-open workshop space, which will be filled with robots and contraptions, etc., that are built by the students. It provides a larger platform for greater experimentation to happen using bigger materials. From the common areas, you reach the first floor through this huge staircase, which consists of the art room and the music room. Upon entering to the first floor, any passerby can see a bunch of foldable doors that are basically panels for students to pin up their art as a form of expression, so that anybody who walks will be able to see the work of the students. They double as a door and as a canvas for expression. The walls of the art room are made white so that the major highlights are the works of arts of the student. And next to that room, you see the music room with the step seating for singing carols, rhymes, shlokas, etc. So this is a section that is cut through the labs where you see the food lab and the art room. This is the staircase that leads up to the art room block where these are those foldable doors that are canvases for free expression. And then you see that the art room is white, all of that. Then this is a section of the music room with the step seating. And just below that you have the biology lab that has the green space over here to grow whatever they need for experimentation. This is the section showing the staircase that is going up and the conversation pit with a hole in the wall and a jali wall over here. A conversation pit for discussions to happen. The labs also have a bunch of skylights that give you light beams into the room that makes the space more bright. So this is the section of the physics lab and the chemistry lab. In the physics lab, you can see the experimental space where you can make all your contraptions in this area. And this is where the actual lab is. This is the chemistry lab, which consists of the periodic table that is inbuilt into the wall, the suspended furniture and all of that. The primary block includes the grades of 1st to 4th with two sections each. Waldorf education stresses on the principle of color and how this affects the growth of the child, and I have tried to incorporate all the principles that help the growth of the child during this stage. The activities of these children include reciting fairy tales, myths, tales from long times ago, rhymes, rhythm, music, and movement. They require imaginative and creative classrooms that provide scope for the imagination. A child can imagine that she's in Neverland like Peter Pan or she's in Wonderland like Alice. They also require a space to keep their creative juices flowing, like sowing seeds, building huts, picking fruits, knitting, painting, working with clay, reading, reciting, writing, etc. When I picture this block, I see children are out digging in the field, sowing, reading, under the trees, chopping, cooking, etc., all the while learning while doing. Once you enter into the main gate of the primary block, you will see that the floor is filled with color tiles of primary colors. Waldorf education says that color, so red and orange, are vital for the children at this age. The block consists of two different modules that are repeated two times. The blocks are made of rammed earth, and the first and the second grade have a staircase leading to the playpen or the fort. The basic idea of this block is 1. The furniture of the block is designed to be inbuilt so that the children have more space and room for play. The second one, circle time is an important feature in Waldorf primary schools where they share events of the day, making children more confident adults. There are two doors for the entry. One door is a large door for the adults, while there is also a small door that only the kids can enter into, giving them an element that they can own. Sometimes, something that they can perceive. They also have a small red oxide pit for more private play experience. The floor walls and the roof are designed with all kinds of activities like rock climbing walls, sketchboards, hole-in-the-wall tunnels, etc. that provide major scope for the imagination as opposed to a boring, plain, four-walled classroom. Every block has a whole world inside it. The entire kindergarten itself forms an ecosystem of its own and creates a place for building stories. My hope is that when people walk into this building, they will get to know a little bit about the type of the people that belong here, instead of using a signage that tells you what block it is. There is a toilet that is situated in the end of one of the plus, which are age appropriate. This consists of a water body on both sides, which have fish for the children to look after as their own. One of the main important feature of this block is the door that leads to the orchid. The orchid has bunch of flowering trees and fruit trees where children can go apple picking, mango picking, etc. A small red door leads you out into the orchid, which kind of makes me think of Narnia, where there is a whole nother world behind one single door for play. The sections of the primary block are designed to promote maximum levels of play and exploration. I've provided depressions in the walls, hole in the walls, over water bodies, a fort bridge, rock climbing walls, skylights, etc. This is a section showing the hole in the wall that acts as a portal to the orchard. A small red door like Narnia that is in the scale of a child. One wall of the classroom has a huge giant abacus which becomes an architectural element as well as a learning tool. There are skylights providing light beams into the block. There is another depression in the wall over the water body where children can gaze out into the abyss, sitting higher than everyone else. The red oxide pit is at a lower level than the rest of the classroom, which have small windows to peep into the orchard and a shelf for storybooks, which creates a sort of a calm environment for you to read. On special days, they can fill up the pit with water and use it as a pool, or they can build Lego models and create a ball pit or a Lego pit, etc. The doors act as blackboard canvases for children to draw and scribble on and express themselves. There is a rock climbing wall on the inside and skylight sending light beams, and the fort where you can talk to your friends from the other classrooms. Also, you get a good view of the orchard from there. From the bottom, if a child stands and looks up, it will appear that the sky is divided. This is because of the extended forts above. The high school and the middle school is the largest block on the campus, having three floors with sloping roofs and bamboo columns. My visit to Bali Green School inspired me majorly with the concept of learning beyond four walls, sitting out in the open amidst nature, like how the first classrooms were made studying under the tree and learning in nature, like how God intended it. The high school block is at the highest contour level, and this block can be visible from the road. The classrooms are differentiated into three levels. The ground floor has three classrooms, the first floor has two, and the third floor has one classroom. Behind the classrooms, the students get a view of the boulders and the hillocks at the back portion of the site. There is a spiral staircase leading to the summit of the block where the entire view of the school can be seen. The classroom doors act as angle measurers, as there are protractors placed below the door. The structure is covered with thatch and consists of bamboo columns supporting the floors above it. The arches or the holes in the wall promote a place for seating for the students to sit and talk to their friends. There is a spiral staircase leading to the summit of the block. The classroom stands on the multipurpose hall that can be used for dance, drama, etc.